Ladies and gentlemen, they say if you dream it, you can become it. I'm reminded of this saying because our panel discussion is going to be centered on the future of network security, where we say that if you can visualize it, you can actually fix it. So this session will delve into the subject of the much important aspect, which is the security, and understand what's concerning the CISOs the most. I'm all set to warmly welcome and invite an array of mavens whom you're going to be shortly seeing on the screen. So allow me with some good cheer and some happy tweets coming in. Let's welcome Mathan Babu Kasilingam, the Chief Technology Security Officer and Data Privacy Officer from Vodafone Idea. Warm welcome to you, Mr. Kasilingam. We'll be hearing your insights shortly. Allow me to rope in your co-panelist. Let's also welcome Manish Misra, the Chief Innovation Officer from Panasonic India. Welcome, Manish. With that, let's invite Vikas Yadav, the CISO from Nykaa. Ladies and gentlemen, hi, Vikas. We'll also be inviting Pavan Chawla, the Chief Information Security Officer and the Data Protection Officer from Future Generali India Life Insurance. Let's also invite Vinod Bhatt, the Chief Information Officer from Vistara Airlines, known as Tata SIA Airlines Limited. Well, the session would be moderated by Murli Rao, the Partner Cybersecurity and Resilience Consulting from EY India. Well, Mr. Rao, if you're all set, here's handing it over to you straight.
Thanks a ton, Shikha. Thank you. And a very warm welcome to all the panelists. It's an absolute pleasure to be talking to you about this particular topic today. I mean, this is core and central to all our functions, you know, as we lead our life in today's world, which has undergone a huge change from the huge amount of digitization that has happened thanks to COVID, and the huge amount of hyper-automation that has happened in the industry side, you know, whether you look at manufacturing or whether you look at any of the industries which have a physical form factor attached to it, not necessarily only in the digital world. So these kinds of, you know, business disruptions have led to a complete change in the way we think about network and the way the network has been in the past, but there are new connotations and new issues associated with network today. Prime of all, to begin with, you know, the assets have most of the assets are no longer in you know, a physical realm of a data center as it used to be in the past. It may be in a private cloud, it might be in a hybrid environment. More and more environments are going and adapting multiple software as a service technologies, whether it is Salesforce.com or SuccessFactors or I'm sorry, whatever it might be. There is a huge amount of data information which is again going out to the cloud in third-party environments. The dependence on supply chain and the technology handshake with the supply chain, irrespective of what kind of business you are in, the context of the supply chain and the third parties and fourth parties might vary a little bit, but the reality is that you need to deal with the tech-to-tech handshakes on a day-to-day basis and exchange of information on a day-to-day basis. So the world of architecting a safe and secure network which has the capability to defend itself from the huge amount of cyber attacks that are happening, that are manifesting on our enterprises. I mean, you almost hear about ransomware demands, ransomware attacks, and malware attacks on a day-to-day basis. Phishing has become a part of our everyday agenda, running anti-phishing campaigns and blocking emails, examining payloads. This has become our day-to-day nightmare that one needs to deal with. And most of all, almost all the enterprises have jumped into, adapted the digital bandwagon in a big way, which means that DevOps is a big, big play for every enterprise out there. So securing DevOps, providing the right access at the right time, for the minimal amount of privileges that one might need, whether it is a DevOps or any of your consumers, consumers in your enterprise, it's another issue that has complicated our landscape. So This is a very, very interesting topic that we are going to be discussing today. The future of network security. Well, is there a network anymore? You know, at least is there a network that used to have a physical connotation attached to it in a predefined realm? It's no longer there. It's all virtual. You know, today the language that we all speak is all about infrastructure as a service, element as a service, code as a service. We talk about platform as a service, IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, you know, all kinds of services are being laid out there, which essentially means that we have embraced the virtual world. We have embraced the virtual world. We have embraced the cyber space. So defense, security, protection, this is the name of the game. And in the near future, we'll also be talking about cyber safety as well. But that's not the topic of the day today. So from that particular context, you know, if you actually look at, you know, the various different software-defined everything that we have, whether it is networks or whether it is edge or whether it is WANs or, you know, everything, you know, it involves a lot of issues around how to go about defending and securing our networks today. So let's start with a few questions centered around, you know, how the trust element in the network is getting gowned at this particular point of time, because if people operate from home or people operate from multiple different devices. So if I can start the conversation with Manish, if you don't mind, if you can, you know, start to talk about the context of trust in the network. You know, how are you dealing with, or what's your take on dealing with trust in the network?
Sure. I think that's a very good question, given the relevance of the topic here. So before I jump into that, there are a few things which we all have been noticing. If you look at the kind of, you know, budget companies are allocating towards cybersecurity has gone up. The cybersecurity has become a very interesting and very important topic in context of India, given the pace of digitization that is happening. And especially during the last 1.5 years, if you look at, you know, due to pandemic, you see, you know, remote workforce, managing remote workforce, people logging from their personal, you know, computer, people logging from their tablets, from their mobile. So overall, it has kind of, you know, become a little bit of challenging environment. Having said that, there are multiple ways to tackle that. Of course, there are multiple challenges because of, you know, the on-prem versus, you know, cloud versus hybrid model, like you were touching upon. So in order to build the trust, there are multiple technologies or multiple ways one can do that. But certainly, one of the things which is kind of, you know, evolving is the zero trust network, which is what is kind of, you know, most of the companies and organizations are moving towards, where you don't trust anybody until you're verified. So in that context, you know, what happens is that you have to kind of, you know, start putting your product surface. So basically your product surface is made of the network's most critical and valuable data points, assets, application and services, which we call DAS. So you start to identify those. With your product surface identified, you can identify how traffic moves across the organization in relation to product surface. And once we understand that, who are the users, which applications they are using, how they are connecting and how they are accessing, you know, start to determine what kind of, you know, policies you have to ensure. You know, you can ensure access level policies, you can ensure, you know, user management level policies. And once you understand the interdependencies between the DAS, infrastructure, services, application, then you start to put in your product surface as close possible as to the micro perimeter. So in that sense, basically, if you look at, there are layer 7 policy based on the Kipling models that gets applied, which becomes, you know, who, what, when, where, why, and how. So those are the things that are kind of, you know, sort of gaining a lot of traction. The second important thing which is also happening is the serverless computing, because if you think of it, earlier you used to have, you know, your servers which are either on the private cloud or your, you know, on-prem computing power. But with the serverless model, you can actually create your servers for the time you need, and then they appear and then they disappear. So it becomes very difficult for hackers to kind of, you know, get to know, you know, what is happening in the system. So I think those are the few things. Also, a lot of use of machine learning, AI kind of, you know, technology, so that you can monitor what is happening, what kind of, you know, usage patterns are happening in your network. You know, so those are a few things. And also SDN is also getting a lot of tractions, you know, because of the nature of it kind of, you know, abstracts a lot of things. So those are the things that I would sort of touch upon, Murali.
Oh, thanks, Manish. You know, just coming over to you. When we talk about zero trust computing, whether it is not only related to network access, but also ensuring that zero or lean trust, depending upon how you look at the connotation from the eyes of your network and your enterprise, you know, have you thought about, well, you know, how would SASE, play a role, in ensuring that your edge is secure, and also the technology to technology and the human to technology handshakes that happen in your enterprises get monitored for that session. And have you actually explored the possibility of moving away from, no trust to ensuring that trust is enforced through some mechanism, Vinod?
Thank you, Murali, for having me as part of this panel discussion. So really privileged. So I will take probably Manish's the conversation a little bit further. That, see, if you look at the perimeter of the organization, it is no more what we talked about probably 2 years back. The perimeter itself has changed. So I think we need to really look at our asset inventory, first of all. Or when I say assets, it's about your data, it's about your apps, it's your networks, it's your edge devices, everything. I think we need to really look at it. And then you need to categorize which are the critical assets and really create micro segments of your network. So you don't have to spend tons of money on an app, on a device, which is okay. Yeah, you need to have skill privilege, but I think you need to do that. And that's the first work we need to do. If you have to really create an architecture which is secured, particularly from the business point of view. So you can create a, you know, gold, silver, copper kind of networks where your gold is where you really need to invest in terms of the firewalls, in terms of the net controls. And also you should know that these devices, these apps today talk to each other. It is not only that you just hold these under a firewall, but these devices actually talk to each other. And in fact, I'm talking about not only the protocols, I'm also talking about IoT kind of devices, yeah, where the data gets exchanged. And how do you ensure that in this hybrid environment, where the architecture is quite hybrid, the workforce is hybrid, the perimeter is changing. So how do you attack this problem now from holistically an enterprise level? I think there is where the Secure Access Service Edge or SASE comes into picture, where you really consolidate where the network and the security policies converge, tools converge, controls converge, dashboards converge. I think this is a transformation. It will not happen overnight. I think we need to prioritize. We need to look at it where we are, because as an enterprise, many times we don't know how many tools we have got. And some of those tools we have been using for years. So how are these, for example, we're talking about SIM tool, right? Service and security information and event management. Who is checking these logs when the event happens? Are you really consolidating, looking at these logs and putting on the SOC layer, where you say that, this has happened. And it has to be real time. It can't be that, one day before that event has happened. I think those are the transformations we're talking about. And then you put the, zero trust on top of it, where who is accessing the network, whether you have got the only identity issue where you go for the multi-factor authentication, or you have a role-based issue also, where you really give the least privilege to the person who is trying to access it. So there are multiple, strategies which you can develop. But bottom line is, this whole journey of security maturity using SASE has to be enterprise specific, because the maturity varies, the tools vary, and also the expenses or the budget which you have to block as part of it. But it is a must do. It is part of the operating model. I don't think it should be one more topic to be discussed. As the CIOs, CISOs, I think we need to put it very firmly, because it is the question of the survival of the business in a secured and safe way. I'll take a pause here.
No. It is your articulation is spot on, Vinod. I completely agree with you. Just to expand on that conversation from a couple of other this thing, I would like to come to Madan. Madan, in the context of enforcing a zero trust, framework. Let's say a framework. How do you see the alignment of the stakeholders in the enterprise? The architects are key to this conversation. The CIOs are key, as Vinod was saying. CISOs are key. Then there is the data, custodians who are absolutely critical. So do you see today enterprises are mature enough to say, I need all these stakeholders on the table for me to be able to actually evolve this particular journey or this particular framework, Madan?
See, I think taking the topic to a zero trust environment is a very complex affair for a, let's talk it in twofold. For a digitally born company, a natively digitally born company, possibly there exists a set of scenarios where this could be achieved through in a span of limited timeline. But in India, we definitely have to appreciate the fact that there are companies which are decade-old, multi-decade-olds that do exist, which has gone through a possible set of IT transformation over the past decade and then possibly a digital transformation over the past few years or so. So, obviously, then comes the aspect of where these data lie. So, the first and foremost context is today to relate back network as the brain. Network, obviously, in the connected world that we live in, network is the brain. So it provides you with as much of information as well as much of controls that we will have to put essentially as to come again in the network in itself. So if we look at two different dynasty of companies, historic ones versus the digital native born companies, it is relatively a mammoth effort for the non-digitally born companies today to set up a complete zero trust way to secure the corporate environment for them. The expansion, the digital expansion obviously has led to a humongous amount of data. And today if we look at, because network was the brain, the data has dispersed away from the core boundary that it was originally there. Today to as many places, you may want to call that out as public cloud, you may want to call it out as digitally distributed analytical infrastructure, big data analytics, etc., etc. For various business analytics purpose, the so-called crown jewel data now has already transferred or into places where possibly people have limited set of view and visibility to it. So while I agree to the topic, if you can't see it, you can't fix it. At least CISOs are not given the choice to tell that you can't fix it if you can't see it. Yeah. So that choice doesn't rest with the CISO, whether you see it or not. If there is a situation tomorrow, you are the person accountable for it. So in the effort that as CISOs that we are trying to take is to ensure that we gain the visibility. Yeah. To the extent that we are in a position to fix it as quicker as possible, that we are able to gain this visibility. So for me, zero trust is a long way journey forward for us. It's not a technology adoption at the first go to look at. It's like what any corporate would want to call it as a complete DNA change for them. Adopting and accepting zero trust is a complete DNA change for a corporate. And definitely without these stakeholders' involvement, it's practically impossible for older firms to go and acquire this as a reality today. But where do we stand today? Are we able to get a hearing from all of these stakeholders? that I think is largely left to the culture of the company and the individual who is driving this agenda, right? So how well are you able to draw the attention of these stakeholders and drive home your primary focus of driving zero trust determines the ability for the corporates to go and achieve zero trust, Murali. So that's a nutshell that I thought I should share, and then leave it open for the subsequent queries.
No, it's a very pragmatic issue that you brought out. It's a very practical. I mean, for legacy companies who have had legacy infrastructure, there is definitely some amount of challenges that is involved in adapting to a zero trust framework. Now, let's get the perspective of Vikas. I mean, he's one of those. He's the innovation officer of one of the best companies in India right now. Vikas, you are born in the digital world company, right? As Madan was indicating, so you are at the other extreme of this conversation. How what I'm really interested in is that have you been able to enforce the zero trust principles by getting all these stakeholders together, and what would be the top five principles according to you, Vikas? If you were to throw some light on that.
Thanks, Murali, and ET for giving me this opportunity. I think it's be it zero trust or be it cybersecurity, I think the journey is a combination of influencing stakeholders and also ensuring that the strategy which you built can be executed on ground well. So as other panelists have brought out that most of these solutions or these paradigms are a transformational change. But yes, definitely being a cloud first company, it's easier to implement them. Yes, it is. But you also come to have your own set of challenges in terms of, do you want to sacrifice agility and speed? That means, let's say, cloud native companies, employees are more used to open environments. For example, accessing applications on VPN would be antithesis to a company. So you would generally tend to deploy zero trust solutions or zero trust network access solutions to build this. But another challenge is that the speed at which startups and small cloud first companies go ahead, it's very necessary to try and synergize and integrate all these solutions also together. So you to have a, I don't know what are those five principles, but I'll talk about whatever I'm aware of. And I will just say that I think the base is to have a very strong identity platform. And I think very few organizations focus on it in the initial years. So, so even if you're cloud first, then also identity is not a piece which you pick up, because ideally, if I were to make a cybersecurity roadmap, I would put identity as the first step. But the challenge is the technology comes first and the security is following. So it's always a catch up. So I don't think identity, putting a strong identity base across all applications is one. Second is ensuring that the way you structure solutions, they can integrate with each other. So let's say you pick up a new solution. I think that's where the CIO's role, and Vinod was pointing out earlier that it's a synergization of all these aspects. So where the CIO's role also comes into place in terms of ensuring that the new technology is adopted, they integrate well with the existing ones. So if you don't have integration, then it's very difficult to adopt. Now, a simple example I would give is that for whatever the zero trust network access solutions are proposed, I think very few of them are ones which can work in all the various environments, all the various solutions, or can integrate everything. You may pick up Akamai, you may pick up Netskope, you may pick up the Zscaler, which is the leader, but can they fit in and satisfy all your requirements? They cannot. And that's why zero trust is a journey, I said. You can't completely phase out VPNs. You can pick up, and I think also running things simultaneously and adopting a risk-based approach is correct. I think even Gartner says that instead of adopting zero trust completely, do it in a phased manner. So I will just say keep identity as your strong point. Then also have a simultaneous roll through rather than ensuring a big transformation kind of thing. Run it simultaneously, and having a risk-based approach. So also it is very essential, I think, to ensure that you build in a mechanism wherein you get proper visibility into whatever you are deploying or what you're building up. So the cloud naturally tends itself to improve visibility. So I think as a security professional, why I love cloud, and I think being a cloud native company, being part of cloud native company was one of the key reasons for joining Nykaa, was that you can get visibility much, much faster than what you could get in any other traditional organization. So just to summarize, I'm not able to give the five principles, but identity first approach, adopting a risk-based approach, and taking it on a seamless way, taking step by step, rather than a full big bang approach, would be better. And I think that is where we should slowly transition to adopting a zero trust approach.
No, absolutely, Vikas. I didn't mean to force the principles out of you, but you covered it more or less. You know, Pawan, coming to you, one of the issues, you know, when we started our journey, let's say 15 years back, I think most of us are having gray hairs out here 15, 20 years back. At that point of time, the network was the perimeter, correct? And then people came along, fundas changed, everybody said identity is the perimeter. But now the zero trust principle claims the data is the perimeter. Okay. So wherever you have data, that in itself is your perimeter. So which means you need to guard, you need to take care, you need to design controls, you need to design journeys, which will ensure that the journey of the data, wherever it is going, is completely safe and secure. And that's the whole core principle of a zero trust architecture, right? So from the given that standpoint, what would you suggest would be, let us say, the good starting points for anybody to start to look at adoption of zero trust, Pawan?
Absolutely, Murali, thanks for raising that particular point, because this is need of the hour, and in each and every forum these days, these are the topics which have been discussed, and we have seen most of us, like you correctly said, that have gray hairs, and we have seen that kind of an environment when we used to have everything hosted in a particular center and never used to be on the cloud, and slowly and gradually things started moving on to the cloud. We used to, what we used to call a bug, which was never exploited 20 years back. Today, it has been called vulnerability because there is an exploitability came into the picture. And the terminology has changed from a bug to vulnerability. And that's the kind of shift we have seen today happening. Similarly, what used to be the perimeter earlier, the routers, the switches, the firewalls, which we talked about, which we used to use and then restrict our network at that point of time, has changed, because the storage, which used to be within the within the environment, now has slowly, first it was a private cloud, which it moves, then it's a mixture of hybrid cloud, public and private cloud. Now, with the pandemic, since last year, most of us have started adopting the SaaS-based model, where we are using software as a service. And similarly, the data which used to reside within the organization now has gone onto the cloud. Considering all these aspects, the paradigm shift, the parameters which is changing, security plays a very important role. And before I get into the best practices and control, I would say the security cannot be bring or brought up at a later stage. It has to be brought up at the time of designing the solution itself. And you need to consult or at least involve your security professional while evaluating the solution itself. Like Vinod has talked about the parameter, Manish has talked about identifying resources which are required to be secured. Today, the data which used to be on the cloud, today it is there on a machine which you have given to your employees, and the employees have taken that back home. Now they are accessing it day and night. Now, how do you secure that particular data? Because earlier it used to be the internet which the employees was accessing through your firewall or through your gateways. Now they are using public. I would call it as a public internet because it is there at your house, and there are other devices which are connected to that particular internet connection as well. It could be your Fire Stick, it could be your mobile phone, it could be anything else, and everything is hackable in today's world. There's nothing which has an 100% security, and that is not the terminology which is ever used, but it is going to be used in future as well. So you need to ensure that security is built in within the within the parameter, which is your laptop, desktop, which has been given to the employee, and data is getting secure. Now, what you can do today to secure that out is, first, you need to analyze what your employee is doing, what an employee is doing. And how do you analyze this? By putting in XDR kind of a solution, which basically monitors each and every click, each and every movement of data which is going or happening through the machine. Similarly, when you have a SaaS-based model, when people are accessing the application, whether it is from your network, which is within the organization itself, and while accessing it over the cloud, the tunnel between that plays a very important role. And I would say that while we consider security at all aspects, we should consider when person is accessing it from home, it is not more over a no more a MPLS kind of a environment which a user is accessing it. Either it could be a authenticated network which needs to be in place, or you need to have SD-WAN kind of a network which needs to be placed to ensure security plays a very important security is embedded in the solution which has been provided to the individual. Third thing is, you need to ensure that data which is residing on the network is encrypted, because user might have left the laptop unattended, the data is still lying in the machine. So what if somebody accesses it, or somebody steal the machine itself? I mean, you forget it somewhere, or somebody breaks into your car, or somebody takes the laptop away while doing certain activities, because it's a normal practice. When the machine is at place, people try to use it for multiple purposes. It is not only the business purposes it has been used for. So you need to ensure that people are not accessing unauthorized sites, which they used to. So when it was a corporate environment, it was much easier, because everything was routing through your firewall. So hence, because there is no physical device, so there is no firewall which is in place when people are accessing it from over. So the next generation firewall needs to be adopted. And as soon, the sooner you adopt, the sooner you will be able to implement the security. So whatever they are doing, you should be aware of what kind of traffic they are accessing, what kind of things they are downloading, is something which you need to get a visibility on, which is very much important to ensure that there are no malware, no firmware, no ransomware kind of a bots which are embedded in the system, and they should get automatically deleted from the system itself.
Thanks, Pawan. Sorry, you wanted to go ahead?
No, I wanted to say to answer that particular question, I would pause here there are many things. Otherwise, I'll keep on going and add more perspective from the security standpoint. There are other things to be added here before I moved on to the other aspect. So I'll pass it to you now.
Yeah, just in the interest of time, please don't get me wrong. We just have approximately another 10 minutes or 12 minutes, if I'm not wrong, for this particular session. So let me pull in another one or two more topics, because this topic is too big, as all of us know, we can spend the next one or two days and still keep talking about all these things. So one very important aspect of it is, which I think Vinod or Manish highlighted earlier, in the conversation, was about the importance of monitoring what is going on our assets and on our data. Now, the focus has moved to the data, and hence the behavior of any access to the data, any access to the data needs to be monitored comprehensively. We are all from the world of security monitoring, which typically is an SIEM. As we all know, SIEM is a post-facto system, and it works on some static rules, and it works on some static signatures that have been there out there. Now, world has moved to a big data platform. There are many vendors who offer a big data platform as a security monitoring service. But in my world, the domain of enforcement of zero trust requires one more level of visibility, which is what we call as observability. Observability is the state of the asset which has your core data. So if you have to have visibility to the state of the asset, then you are not only going to be looking at security events, but you're also going to be looking at IT events. And thereby, you would need to have generate comprehensive visibility for this on an ongoing basis. So, Vinod, is there, what's your take on network related observability, not only from a security standpoint, but also from an IT standpoint, Vinod.
Yeah, I will make my answer crisp. I know that others have to also jump in. Yeah. See, I will probably make 2 points. One is, in traditional world, we used to have NOC, Network Operating Center, and we used to have SOC. These two have to merge, as simple as that. If I have a network up and running, but what is going on inside the network, only security tools can tell me. So I think that whole convergence and looking from the monitoring endpoint point of view is very important. And I talked about SIEM, right? SIEM kind of tools where you really talk about the event if it has happened anywhere, whether it's an end device, whether it's in the network, whether it's on the firewall, how quickly I can get that alert, how quickly it's basically consolidated with is there, and how quickly I can take an action. I think there is where the whole application, network, and security. So you talked about data. Yes, it is data, it is assets, application, and services. I think the whole integration, people are giving it different names, you know, security operating operation center, or also now called digital command center. They are not talking about anymore a network or a security. It's a command center of the enterprise where you are worried about application, you are worried about data. I think there is where the industry is going, and there is what I would probably put it on the table.
No, absolutely. You said it. Thank you for that. Manish, just coming to you quickly for, if we have to look at, from a security posture management perspective, in your current network, and when you move to the zero trust world, what do you think would be key for you to minimize your risks and visualize your threats? For me, it is the perspective of merging all this, as Vinod was talking about. Have you made any efforts towards that? Is there a roadmap around that?
Yes, I think so. That's a very interesting question. And I think Vinod was kind of alluding to that. I will elaborate a little bit further on top of that. So today, if you look at the boundaries between IT team and security teams are getting blurred, so to say. And that's where the convergence is happening, and it is very much needed today, because as soon as you when the cloud adoption happened, there was an immediate need of a lot of DevOps skills. People are talking about automation and DevOps and all that. But now it is moving towards DevSecOps, because security has become a very integral part of this whole ecosystem, right? And you cannot ignore that. So I can give you some of the real life examples, because from a Panasonic point of view, security, privacy are very, very important point for us, right? So at India Innovation Center, we create new platforms, new solutions. We take security and privacy very close to our heart. So like, I think if you think about it, if you have not thought about it in the beginning, then it's a Herculean task to do something as a reactive measure, which becomes a very big task. While if you are doing incremental, I think Vikas was talking about it earlier, if you start taking those incremental steps from the beginning itself, where you keep security by design, privacy by design principles in mind for the platforms that we create, over a period of time, it becomes everything coming together. So last year, we launched our Mirai platform, which is our IoT and AI enabled, platform for connected appliances. So most of the Panasonic appliances that go inside a house, whether it is air conditioners, refrigerator, washing machine, those are on that platform. Now you think of amount of data going through these devices to the cloud. And last week we launched our industrial IoT platform, Mirai Pro Factory. There is again huge amount of data going to the cloud. So you have to be very, very careful while data in motion, what kind of security parameters you take, while data is at rest, what kind of security parameters you take, all those things put together. So of course, dashboards are there, lot of data coming from different channels, but like because Vinod was saying earlier, no longer network and IT are two different teams. These are converging, and that's where the real value will come, when we will visualize everything what is happening. So that is how it
I can pitch in.
Please, Vikas. Yeah.
So from a observability perspective, at least I have seen as a cloud cognitive company, it's very important to have a cyber attack surface monitoring solution or methods to do them. So now this can actually reach better dividend than even an SIEM, where you have logs coming in from so many devices and then waiting for them to correlation to happen and alerts to be generated. Now there's so many attack surface monitoring tools like BitSight, UpGuard, Risk Recon, and we also use some of them. What happens is you immediately come to know if a port is open, if a new domain has been published, and you can immediately react to it. There's some of the solutions can even tell you if one of your IPs is communicating with a command control center immediately, much faster than your SIEM solution. Even on cloud, the new age cloud security posture management tools like Prisma, Dome9 and Orca, they can give the kind of visibility they can give you at an instant. Let's say it takes almost only a day to set it up, and you can immediately start getting a complete view of your cloud environment with the small issues marked by severity, which a conventional SIEM solution will take much more point. I have another view of attack observability, even something simple thing like responsible disclosure and bug bounty can be a way of getting observability, because you can do a lot of internal testing, you can do a lot of external testing, but what you can get from a pool of people who actually are interested in finding out research, and if you have a effective responsible disclosure bug bounty program, the visibility which you can get into your issues is much faster. So I think using all these kind of tools and internal ones as well will definitely help you become much more secure in the modern environment.
No, that's very helpful. Those are some practical issues that you brought out to ease out the rollout of observability. One quick one. So Pawan and Matan, probably we'll have a minute to each of you. You know, we are almost here on the dot. What does it take for you to build comprehensive observability? You know, when we talk about, while Vikas shared the perspective of there are many point products which provide it, but if I have to have a comprehensive perspective of what's happening on my data at any given point of time and have my response also adequately factored out, what does it take? Do you think you have the skills and competence inside the teams for you to be able to build out an observability lake? And the content,
the challenge is slightly different, Murli. See, while I beg to differ with some of the views some of my co-panelists shared, to the extent that today there exists technology. See, whether you call SOC, NOC, SIEM in whichever manner, all of these are actually sensors. They are receiving events. It's a lens is the manner that I look up to each of them. Which is kind of purpose built to show from the data what it has collected to what you intend to see. SOC could possibly show you security oriented events. Possibly a NOC is designed to show you what are network oriented events. But each of them are essentially getting the events from the same source. Yeah, and the events that possibly might capable of going to both these destination also possibly could be the same. So it's a lens, right? So when I look at it as a lens, I don't look at it as a convergence that is essentially needed. These exist already. It is the way that we have been looking at. So the existence of technology as a challenge is no more. Yeah, it is how you look at. So, but coming back to your question on are we adequately prepared by people's ability to make sure that they do this lens change as appropriately, there we have a serious set of issues, right? So from what is coming to me to what I land up seeing, that lens, technically it is possible, but then ability wise we are still lagging. It's not only our problem, it's a global problem. The ability of people to modify these technologies to relate back well, and as well in process. The moment technically able people are available, you would definitely be able to change the process. So I look at it as technical, yes, fulfilled. People and process side, there is a lot of work that we will have to do to accomplish this mission.
Yep. No, that's another perspective. I completely accept that there is a perspective out there, Matan. Pawan, last one to you in the interest of time. I'll still come back to the same question. I would want to understand this perspective from you. Observability is the state of data at any given point of time, right?
So I completely agree to what Matan has said, and I am of the same view. The only thing which I want to add on top of it is getting to know about what is there and looking at from a different lens is one aspect to it. And second is taking action on those things which have been getting reported either through SOC or through NOC. The challenges is the resources, the understandability, and addressing the concerns which have been getting reported. And that is there. I see a huge gap because people are there. They are transactional people. They are not business people. They don't understand how to correlate and how to get into to the root cause of addressing a concern. And that is where I see a gap, which at present is there in most of the services which you opt for. And that is something which needs to be focused upon and fixed to ensure that that gap is filled and you get into insecurity from all aspects.
No, thanks, Pawan. Thank you to all the panelists. I think we are just on time or probably a couple of minutes late. Here are a few takeaways. Number one, security by design, privacy by design. If you get these two right, then what you have in your enterprise is you will have trust by design. Now, this trust by design is absolutely critical. Whether it is from a network standpoint, trust by design, enforcement of trust by design happens through the zero trust principles, which is absolutely critical for the cyber defense of any particular enterprise. Now, if you have to move forward in this particular journey, it's absolutely critical to take a very data-centric perspective of the whole solution, of the whole framework, in order for us to be able to ensure that the most critical aspect of every enterprise is the data, and whether it is data of a financial transaction or some other transaction, but at the end of the day, it is all about data. So, one big takeaway for everyone is the visibility of a network is all about ensuring that you enforce the right level of trust, if not zero trust, to the most core and critical data in your enterprise. So with that, gentlemen, thanks a ton for sharing your thoughts with me. It was an absolute pleasure talking to all of you. Shikha?
Mr. Rao, it was absolutely our pleasure listening to all the thoughts that have flown in. Thank you very, very much to you for weaving through it. And of course, with the security gaining priority in digital strategies, all of us definitely owe a big thank you to our panel members for evaluating the security responsibility. As you said, maybe if not zero trust, but otherwise, and especially with the sense of urgency that you all talked, and thereby giving a sense of how to transform the IT culture therein. Thank you very, very much. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, as we are slowly and steadily marching towards the final leg of our summit, there is a fireside chat coming right your way. We'll be right back on the screen. Just last few minutes left for all of you to engage in any of the experiential platform features. If you haven't till now, I'm keeping a tab on your leaderboard scores. So I hope you're faring well on that. I'll see you right back.